our services this morning. A couple of announcements that we have, as usual, Tuesday morning class reading and Wednesday night Bible study. And Lord willing, and the creek doesn't rise, we'll have potluck next Sunday. So that'll be a new experience for all of us. All right. Let me begin our worship hour with us with reading from Psalms chapter 36. Sin whispers to the wicked deep within their heart. They have no fear of God at all. In their blind conceit, they cannot see how wicked they really are. Everything they say is crooked and deceitful. They refuse to act wisely or do good. They lie awake at night hatching sinful plots. Their actions are never good. They make no attempts to turn from evil. Your unfailing love, O Lord, is in the vast as the heavens. Your faithfulness reaches beyond the clouds. Your righteousness is the mighty mountain. Your justice like the ocean's depth. You care for the people and the animals alike. O Lord, how precious is your unfailing love, O God. All humanity finds shelter in the shadow of your wings. You feed them from the abundance of your own house. Let them drink from the rivers of delight, for you are the fountain of love and the light by which they see. Pour out your unfailing love on those who love you. Give justice to those who honor heart, who are with honest hearts. Don't let the proud trample me or the wicked push me around. Look, those who do evil have fallen. They throw down and never are raised again. Thank you, dear Father, for your love and your encouragement that your word gives us. We know, Father, that you love us. You have allowed us to be blessed by you. And we thank you, Father, for the many blessings that you do give us each day. Help us to remember that our gifts from you come from you, and as long as we follow your path and your light that lights up our ways as we walk in your word. Thank you, Father, for your love that you've given us. Be with us in our worship hour to come. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Speaks a little louder than Alan does. I had it turned up for Alan last week. So, well, good morning. Welcome, Grace Fellowship. Saw a lot of rain clouds going around the edge of town. Some people got some rain yesterday. We're thankful for people that got the rain. We're hopefully we're getting the rain today or tomorrow. So the official end of summer is today or tomorrow, I guess, whatever. But whatever. Anyway, September 1st, unbelievable. We're in September already. Anyway, let's stand and sing. We're going to praise God. We're going to have communion today. Remember him and his sacrifice for us. We're going to start with what we're here for. We're made to worship him.
Story of his love for everyone.
I did that to you, that high song. We've been struggling with that all morning. Mm-hmm. It's a great song, though. Made me worship. Now we are here. Come thou found.
Came and set me free. Now my soul.
seated. All good things come from God. Worship you in spirit and in truth. we can fall down on our knees, worship the one true God, the only God. Lord, just take this time today to remember your son Jesus as he, as we remember the Last Supper, him preparing to die upon that cross for us, Lord. And of course, we know it didn't end there, that he arose victorious over death and sits at your right hand interceding for us each and every day, Lord. And we're so thankful that we do have a mighty Savior. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
I invite you this morning to take your scripture, if you would, and go to 1 Timothy in chapter 5 is where we're going to pick up where we left off last week. And really in setting the precedent for the next few Sundays, we laid some foundational work last week. And so we want to refer to that. And then we want to look at really in just a common rhythm of Scripture where we go next. I want to direct your attention, though, to the purpose statement of this book, because it's going to be most paramount, if you will, for the next few Sundays. We say things like this, just do your job. We're classic about just go and get it done and do what I told you, or fulfill the expectation that is before you. And oftentimes, in all sincerity and in all honesty, sometimes we don't know what that means, to go do your job. And we don't know what the expectation is, and we don't really know what the example is that we're to follow after. And those are honest places to land. And I really think that's what the Apostle Paul's doing to Timothy. Timothy, I've given you all of this instruction, and I've warned you against those people who are heretics, and they're speaking all kinds of evil. He even calls it doctrines of demons. And I want you to mark those people out, and I want you to reestablish those things of engagement and improper polity in the church. You need to ordain godly men to be elders and godly men to be deacons. And I'm even going to give you the qualifications. You don't even have to come up with that on your own. And all of these marching papers, and then basically in chapter 5, he says, now, I want you to take all of that in application to the body. If he would have left out chapter 5 in totality, then Timothy, I think, at times could have said, well, Paul, I understand what I'm looking for. I understand what it looks like according to Scripture, and I know what my charge is, but I don't really know how to do it. I don't really know how to just go do my job. Go accomplish your good intent and your calling. Well, sometimes I think that that's how we feel as believers, and oftentimes we look at a passage or a pastor will say something, and your heart's desire is to do that which is pleasing to God. I'm going to give everybody in this room that benefit of doubt. If I said, do you want to do God's will, and you're going to say, I believe, in response to that, well, of course, Rob, I want to be found in the will of God. I want to be doing the things that are acceptable on the side of God, as we will see the terminology this morning in this passage. But I don't really know what's expected of me. I don't really know what that looks like in reality. Here's life right here today. What do we do when the responsibility has been handed to young Timothy to be a good steward of his calling, of his appointment, of his commissioning? And in that, Paul does not leave him desirous in not only to identify what is his in Christ Jesus, but then how to put it into application in the body. And I can just tell you, if you ever have questions about the will of God, just go to the Word of God. It wasn't but just a few verses. I'm sure Timothy is now thinking when he ends that chapter 4, okay, Paul, all that's great and I get it, but I don't know how to use any of this. I don't know what to do. And Paul says, look, just read the rest of the letter. Just pick up where we left off and read the rest of the letter. And I'm going to show you how to apply this today. All right, three groups for the next few Sundays. Widows, elders, and slaves. Okay, so if I was just to take a cross-section of the body at Ephesus, this is pretty much going to take care of everybody in the church at Ephesus. We have some reality about life happening to certain women in the church, i.e., widowed. We have elders that are going to be raised up through the appointment and commissioning of God Himself and recognized in the body because they meet the requirements of an elder or a deacon, according to the word. The rest of everybody falls into the next bowl, and they're slaves. You say, well, Rob, was everybody in the church at Ephesus a slave? Had they all been conquered people? Not all of them. But guys, I'm going to show you in a few weeks, slavery is not in Scripture always a negative thing. We are all slaves of somebody or something. Jesus looks at his disciples, and the masses have gathered the latter part of his ministry, and he says, all of us are subject to or slaves to one or the other. Satan, who is the master of the world, or Jesus Christ, who is the ruler of all. You will bend the knee to one or the other. Who are you? A slave to the world and all of its evil and all of its anti-characteristics of Christ? Or are you a slave of the one, the Most High, Jesus Christ? You're going to follow one of two masters. Guys, the terminology in Scripture already dictates that we are a slave to something. I want to be mastered by the one who chose me pre-foundation in salvation. I want to be known as a slave of Jesus Christ. And when I see this laid out in Scripture, when we get to that of slavery, he just basically takes the entire congregation at Ephesus and he says, whether you're a free man or you're a slave, you're going to be a slave to somebody. Find yourself aligning yourself with the doctrines of grace. That you're a born-again child of God. Walk in that you've been called in, a slave of Jesus Christ. Guys, that's not negative. I want to show you this morning that is, again, set in the precedent of what we're going to deal with widows for the next couple of Sundays is not a negative, though it is corrective speech. Today, the instruction is for correction. I'm not going to go through all of the mechanics of the passage that we're going to deal with for the next, really, 3 through 16. The largest portion of Scripture that deals with widows, by the way, categorically is going to put widows in one of four categories. You're a widow indeed. We're going to define that this morning. You're a widow with relatives or family members. You're a carnal widow. You need some instruction about how to live your life now that you have been bereaved or left in loneliness without. And lastly, we're going to look at, as a scripture, those widows who made the list. They're somehow on a list. And what does that mean? And how did they get on the list? And how did others not get on the list? Four categories of being a widow. Well, this morning we're going to look at two of them. What is a widow indeed? And what is it to be a widow with family that's still living? Man, this is so practical. I don't want us to miss this. Guys, one of the most cheerful things that a body has really in reflection of the beauty of salvation is how we treat widows. The Scripture is replete. It is pregnant. It is almost to the place of bursting. Of what God intends the church to do and the saints to do in lieu of widows in your body. I can go all the way back to Moses' writing in Levitical law and in Exodus, passages of Scripture about the beauty of how God fends for and takes care of orphans and widows. Those who really have nothing. I can get into the prophets of Jeremiah and Isaiah, and I can get into the songs of Psalm and really the accomplishment of Solomon and all of his wisdom in Proverbs. In every single place you land, there's a place of beauty about widows and orphans. And you roll into the New Testament, I want to just show you one this morning. I want you to go to James in chapter 1, and I want to pick up there as we kick this off, as we really have a starter for the identification of the body's really response to grace and what you do with a particular group called widows in your body. I want to pick up in verse 17 of James chapter 1. I want to wait till you get there because I want you to see this. The terminology is strong in this passage. If you go back to the original text, James, the half-brother of Jesus, could not have chosen stronger words in the original language than these words that he chooses. Listen to verse 17. Every good thing bestowed and every perfect gift is from above, coming down from the Father of lights, with whom there is no variation or shadow. Now remember that. Now drop down to 27. Guys, do you believe that? That every good thing in the body comes from God? And every single good thing that happens in your life comes from God? Can you, I tell you, if you're saying this morning, I believe that, then widows are a good thing in the body of Christ. You're saying, well, Rob, they're a widow because they're bereaved. They're lonely at times because they don't have a husband. Listen, in the accompaniment of Scripture, we must, in context, embrace the goodness of God by allowing us an opportunity to serve orphans and widows well. Look at 27 of chapter 1. This is pure, without spot, and undefiled, unblemished, what? Religion. You say you're of God? You say that you're a follower of Christ? I want to show you what being without a spot and unblemished, pure. I want to show you what God calls purity. What he would say to you in your adornment at the marriage, as a bride would be in respect brought to the front of the auditorium and given away in respect to that which God has ordained in her life. And you hear words like this: who gives this woman to be married to this man? And somebody stands in representative form and says, her mother and I, or whatever. Guys, I've never seen a bride walk down the aisle and all of her beauty that would not have been significantly called out if she would not have had a big old stain on her gown. But when she turns and presents herself to the congregation, in lily white she stands in purity and undefilement. He says, you know what that looks like in Scripture? The beauty that you guys look at and all of the significance of a day of wedding. Can I just tell you, there is a purity and undefilement in religiosity that God says is good. What is it? To visit orphans. That means that you give of your time, you give of your resources, you give of your efforts for those children who do not have parents. If that were just it, then we would finish and we'd go back and say, well, Rob, why did we reflect this as a cross-reference to this morning? Because it's not over. He says, this is pure. This is undefiled. This is what true Christians and godliness do in the sight of our God. They visit orphans and widows in their distress. And they keep themselves unstained by the world. Guys, let me just tell you something, and you can walk out and say, that Rob is one of the craziest guys I've ever met. Hans can walk out right now. Guys, in the body of Christ, now listen to me. God has a system of well-being, of welfare in the body. He does. And it's not the government. It's not. It has never been the government's place to come into the body of Christ, and when an orphan needs some aid, that we do not embrace that moment and raise that child in the admonition of the Lord and take care of the visitation of resource and of time and of demand and of time struggle and heartbreak, that we embrace that as the body of Christ, but not just for the orphan, but for the widow. It has never been the government's job to take care of those two people. Guys, remember the day standing on the playground as a kid and your PE instructor would come out? You remember those days, and We're going to play flag or whatever, flag football. We're going to play tag or whatever. I need two captains. And they would pick two kids from the group. And you'd have all these little kids like little birds just waiting to be picked. Without hesitation, two people would stand in front of this group of kids, and immediately the hands go up, and the chirping starts, and they start bouncing, pick me, pick me, pick me, pick me, me right here, pick me. Can I tell you in the original text, that's how this is written. Though it is corrective in nature, it's the church of God standing before the person of Christ saying, choose us. Pick us. We'll take care of them. Pick us. Please, God, pick our congregation to take care of orphans and widows. Because we want to one day stand before you in the sight of all the brethren on the day in which we are married to the great groom, Jesus Christ. And here, you did well. Church in Ballinger, Texas, you did well because you were unstained, unblemished in your walk with Christ. Well, God, how? You took care of orphans and you took care of your widows. That's what being undefiled looks like. That's what being donned in the robe lily white looks like. Pick us, God, for all good things come from above. That's the beauty of being a believer in Jesus Christ. Guys, this is a privilege. And you say, well, Rob, I don't feel like that I'm personally called to adopt. Okay. All right. I'll go there with you. But we're all called to take care of the orphan. Well, Rob, I don't know if I have the resources myself or my family to take care of a widow. But we're all called to meet the distress of one who has been left without. Folks, it goes beyond your resources. It goes into the condition of your heart. Is this good? Is this undefiled? Is this spotless in the sight of God? Guys, I could stay on my soapbox forever because this is our passion as the body of Christ. What do we do in real time, in real church life? What do we do? Well, guess what? For the next few Sundays, you're going to go, oh, that's what we do. I hope that's what we say. All right, but I want to direct your attention. I started over here and I got on a soapbox. All right, I want to direct your attention to chapter 3 of 1 Timothy as we start this because the context is very, very important of what we're driving to. Why the book? Why the epistle? Why the letter to Timothy from Paul? Okay, we don't have to ask why very long, and here it is. Beginning in verse 14 through down through verse 15, we have it, and then we're going to see how this is applied beginning in chapter 5. But I'm writing these things to you, hoping to come to you before long. I really want to be there, but until I get there, just take this letter and read the letter. Start practicing the things on the letter. But in case I am delayed, I write so that you may know how one ought to conduct himself in the household of God, which is the church of the living God, the pillar and support of the truth. Oh, so Rob, what's my conduct supposed to be? What's the rhythm of my walk? And what does my gait look like? And what should my habits be? And what are my mannerisms? Guys, this is crazy because, as you guys well know, Zoe wasn't with us during those little ages, those developing months, and even the first couple of years. But it is amazing to me that when we sit around the dining room table, and we were talking about this the other day, and I say to her, you act like and you really carry yourself just like your mom. Well, I'm not talking about a mother in China. though she has a biological mother. I'm talking about Wendy, my wife. She'll say things and she'll do things just like her mom. And I'm thinking, okay, she's not biological, but she's taken on the characteristics of her environment, and she does the things just like her mother in San Angelo. And I'm like, is there not a lesson to be learned in this? Though I was born into sin, conceived by evil, and then born again by the good grace of God, I used to walk like this, and I used to characterize my habits like this, and then God stepped in and He changed me. He did not upgrade my heart. He gave me a brand new heart. I don't have Rob Holis heart 2.0. I have a brand new heart. And guess what? My characteristics, the flavor of my preference, should be what satisfies Him, not me. And I want it to be said of us in our lovely church right here. That church acts just like their Father, Jesus Christ, their Lord. I can tell their followers of Jesus Christ, well, how? They take care of their own. That's how I know. Guys, you think for 1 minute I'm going to wait till November's election to see if it's okay for us to take care of orphans and widows? Please. Come on now. The provision is clear in Scripture what we need to do. So He starts in chapter 5. I'm going to get into the text, I promise. He starts in chapter 5, and He really categorizes, just in a general sense, four different kinds of people. He does it by age, and He does it by gender. Yes, there's only two genders. The Bible only speaks of two genders. And you are born in that, conceived in that gender. That's a gift from God. Male or female. All right, so now I see older men, and how am I supposed to, even in confrontation of wrong, sinful life, how am I supposed to go? He uses two verbs. Do not speak harshly. Do not rebuke harshly. Do not infiltrate their life with demanding words that you criticize and you break them down with your mouth. Don't do that. But in contrast, appeal to them. Come alongside them and walk with them and satisfy the command of Scripture by really taking them into a place of comfort. If not this, then would you look at this, my Father? Because I'm supposed to do it through the stature or the characteristic of that older man is my Father. Family terms. Well, then you see young men. Well, what about young men? Likewise, appeal to them, not with harsh rebuke. Appeal to that young man in what stature, what state? As a brother. Just like you would your own brother. You want the best for your own brother. You want your own brother to benefit, but there may need to be some correction. What's the next step? Well, what about the older women, Rob? As a mother. Nurturing. One giving themselves of you at a time which you could not do for yourself, they did for you. Well, there's one more category, young women. What do we do with them? Treat them like a sister. And then he uses a little tag in all purity. Timothy, you do not violate that young lady. Keep this pure, but minister to her in her need. All right. That is like two verses that fly really high. And now he's going to get right down in the bottleneck. And I want to show you practicality, Timothy, the people, and how it's going to work in your body. First is corrective instruction. You say, well, Rob, okay, so how do you know that? Because of the original text, and we'll see it more clearly next week. But this is what was going on. Much like the passages like in Acts chapter 6, verses 1 through 6. We had some Hellenistic Jews, Greeks who had been converted to Judaism, or to, in fact, in the first century church, to Christianity. They were alienated from their families. They did not have. Therefore, it was really encumbered by the church to see in practical ways take care of them. They were being, the scripture says, overlooked. They were in need, and no one was taking care of that need. Well, then what do we do? Well, we raise up servants. The qualifications are established. The first century church in Jerusalem lays hands on these guys because he was ordained in heaven, recognized on earth, and these guys began to do what? In function of reality, quit overlooking the Hellenistic Jewish widows. Take care of them. Oh, you mean we didn't turn a granny into the government? No. We took care of our own. And guess what? There's not another single time in Scripture you see that correction being made in the first century till you get right here, several years later, in Ephesus. Corrective and instruction because of this. Evidently, we're not taking care of our widows like we should. And Paul knows the bruises. He knows the disjointedness of this body because he knows this body intimately, having pastored them for over 3 years. He says, Timothy, the first thing I want you to do is I want you to take that special group of women that God in goodness has given to the body of Christ, and I want you to start taking care of them. I'm going to tell you in identifiable characteristics four ways they're going to be spotted. All right, number one, there's an overriding theme to all of this, and it begins in verse 3. The very first thing he says that's going to be really the overarching truth to the entire through verse 16 is honor widows. Honor means to put a value, a priceless value, on the life of one widow, bereaved, left on this earth because of the death of her husband. Here she sits in the congregation. She's gone through life, and life has really taken from her, bereaved, robbed her of a relationship that she once had with her husband called marriage. I want you to put a price on that, in that you will value this and you will revere this to the place that you will honor that lady in your church. Now, guys, we can go a lot of different ways because our society, in the decay of the family, we have women now that are being abandoned by their husband. We have them being sent to prison. Guys, you just start naming divorce for no godly reason. Please don't walk out and say, well, Rob, is it only the bereaved because their husband died? That's the context of this passage. But you know that as the church, in practicality, we want to take care of every woman in need in our body that is without. And so there is a priceless gift to the body called widows. And what are we supposed to do? Honor them. All right. First group. Look at the end of verse 3. Honor widows, and the first category are widows indeed. I'm going to define it for you in just a minute. Honor widows who are widows indeed. Drop down to verse 5. Now she who is a widow indeed and who has been left alone. Guys, one of the scary things about this passage is this is tied to culture when it was written. It is not exclusive to the culture. 2,000 years later, these truths are still truths for us to hold on to. But if I'm sitting in the congregation 2,000 years ago, and Timothy says, oh, by the way, I want to read a letter that Paul sent me, and I've looked at it and I've studied it, and this is going to be good medicine for us. And we get to chapter 5, verse 3, and it says, honor widows. Widows indeed, and then I look at verse 5, and it says that they are widows indeed, and they have been left without, and they are lonely. I would immediately start thinking of ladies in my congregation at Ephesus who fit in this category. You know what category it was? They have no provision. If the church doesn't step in. The Roman government wasn't going to do it in Ephesus. They could care less about Christians. They could care less about your congregation. They could care less about your church. So you have women sitting under the reading of this 2,000 years ago, and they're going, man, that's me. Well, what is me? They don't have family to take care of them. Guys, they didn't work outside the home in that day. They were not trained. They were not skilled in doing something that would, outside of that setting, they could just go out in the common byways of life and get a job. Couldn't do it. They literally were in devastation. They had nothing. Widows indeed were widows in need. But listen to how he categorizes them in 5. He says they have been left alone. That is a perfect tense verb. That means something happened in their past, lost, that has a demand on their time even today. It continues. They are fixed in this state of being widowed. But here's what they fixed their heart on. But they have secured or fixed their hope on God. And how do I know that? They continue in entreaties and prayers night and day. Night and day is a common term in Scripture. It means all the time. Here I have a widow indeed who's a born-again child of God. She's a widow indeed because she's a widow in need. She doesn't have family. She doesn't have a provision of protection or really of resource. And here's the condition of that widow's heart. I fixed my heart on God. Why? Because he's my hope. Well, what did God raise up to be her hope? One and foremost, Jesus Christ to save her soul. Secondly, the body to take care of her on earth. And you know what she spends her time doing? She's a prayer warrior. You tell me that's not true, because that's what the passage says. She has fixed her hope on Jesus Christ. And you know what she spends her time doing? Praying, supplicating, requesting, not only for herself, but for everybody in the congregation. How good is it to have widows in our body who are born again and in need, because they become the greatest prayer warriors in your body? Guys, I don't know how many times a widow has come to me early, just having suffered loss, or late and they've been experienced in it and they've lived it for many years. I don't know how many times that widows have walked up to me and said, Rob, I pray for you every single day. Guys, I don't think that that's just for me, because I'm not writing a resume or giving a recommendation, because they don't work. I don't think they're just flattering in speech. I believe they're prayer warriors. How great a good God that would give us the responsibility that I would get to stand on that playground and go, pick us, God, pick us. Because we want women like this in our body. That having suffered loss and they're fixed in that state of loneliness at times, and in desperate need of somebody to come and just give up their time or their resources or their wisdom or their counsel, that we wouldn't have a church member show up like a champ in Christ. And all the while, they're praying the thunder out of heaven for us. Good? Yeah, very good. Look at the end of verse 16. There's another word. The very end of verse 16. I'm going to go into the context. We're going to get to that. So that it may assist those who are widows indeed. What may assist? The resources, the dependency on somebody, i.e. another widow in this case, that has provision, has money, and says, you know what, you're in the same state I'm in. I'm going to give what I have, and I'm going to share it with you. But you see that little word, to assist? That's exactly what it means. It means I'm standing in the line at Sam's next to a lady who has not the resources or the provision to fill her bag or her cart or her bucket. And for everything I take for me, I give in assistance to her. And when we get to the checkout line, she steps to the back. And we pay for it. Folks, that's what the church looks like in Christ. I will assist you in whatever you need. let me take care of that. Can I just say something to you, though? For widows indeed, you may tell you why this is such an intimate thing called family. One of the hardest things for widows to do is take that from you. Guys, it's hard. To have been independent for most of their life and to find themselves in a contrary position. Contrary in that that's not really what they want, but it's where they're at. So guys, with gentleness and mercy and hope, not in flamboyance of calling attention to, but in the quiet spirit of God, would we just take care of our own? So that assistance sees them through life, provided by the good grace of God through His church. Widows indeed, first category. Second category is widows who have family. Ah, this is great. I want to show you just a couple of passages, though, as this is a transition verse in Scripture. I want you to go to Jeremiah. A couple of prophets are going to speak on this, actually. I want you to go to Jeremiah chapter 49 and verse 11. You say, well, where does God really line up in this? Well, just go back to your Old Testament, because it's like interconnective tissue to the reality of the work of the body. This is how it all operates. It's all held together by these tendons and ligaments and muscles and bone. Look at verse 11 of Jeremiah 49. I hear the pages still rolling, so I'm going to give you a chance. I know it's a book you probably were in all week, and so you're just right there ready to go. Leave your orphans behind. War, captivity, difficulty, circumstances in life. Well, what am I supposed to do with these little children that lost their parents? Leave them behind. This is God. What is God going to do? I will keep them alive. I'll take care of them. The psalmist says he becomes the father to the fatherless, that he meets the needs of orphans. Ooh, how? Called the church of the living God. But look at the end of this verse. And let your widows trust in me. Paul looks at Timothy, he says, you may tell you what they trust in? The hope of Jesus Christ. They are fixed in Him. Folks, that's the heart of the widow indeed. Now go back to Isaiah, another prophet, and I want you to see this. Out of chapter 1 and verse 17. This is a learning process, a teaching process. We don't come to this just by a natural habit, because he uses a word to learn, to be instructed by. Isaiah chapter 1 and verse 17. Look at it with me. Learn to do good. Well, Rob, I want to learn to do good. Okay, start doing these things. This is our practice. Seek justice. Do the right thing for the right reasons. That's what that means. Reprove the ruthless. Identify those who are evil. Speak against it. Defend the orphan. Stand up in the parking lot and have a defense for the orphan. They can't fight for themselves. Oh, but listen to how he leaves it. Plead for the widow. Guys, that's a word that says to beseech or to beg of one who can give all hope. Is God is my witness. That's how we pray for the widows of this church. God, please. We beseech you on the power of the hope of Jesus Christ that you will provide for the day that they can't even endure the next moment. There's loneliness, and I know that there are widowers sitting here also that have lost your wife. That's the heart of God. That's the heart of the church. Father, I know they're without. I know they're lonely. I know they're struggling loss. Would you please comfort them with hope? And the beauty of the passage is He does for them what they cannot do for themselves. Guys, I've heard testimony after testimony after testimony of widows and widowers standing up and saying, I did not have, but God provided for me. When I thought all was at loss, He sent somebody. He gave to me. He provided for me. And I don't even know how. I'll tell you how. Because God takes care of His own. And in reasonable practicality, this is how He does it. Folks, don't walk out and say, oh gosh, that's what super churches do, and that's what super saints do. No. This is every day. This is the common man. This is not the ones that have an S on their chest and they go change in some vestibule and come out with some glowing superhero power. This is just Christ in us, the hope of glory. You appear for this moment. Would you please stand up and plead for the widow in our congregation? That is require nothing on your part but entreaties, petitions, and prayer requests. But there is a part of this that the family who is left behind does operate in. And I want you to see it's very strong. First, it is positive. Then it becomes a warning, negative. Beginning in verse 4, living with relatives to support, the scripture says in verse 4, but if any widow has children or grandchildren, let them first learn, what was that out of Isaiah? Learn. What am I to learn? Learn to practice piety. What is piety? Godliness. I want to look like God. Well, then what does it look like? What do we practice? Look at it. In regard to their own family and to make some return to their parents, for this is acceptable in the sight of God. Guys, I've told you this a million times now in the few years that I've pastored here. People have always walked up to me and say, Rob, I just want to go know God's will. This is God's will. Quit making this bigger than it is, though this is big. Quit trying to read into passages of Scripture that is some kind of huge, flamboyant, colorful, and it has all of this smoke and mirrors. This is what normal Christianity looks like. This is what is engaged in by the Holy Father in heaven as acceptable in His sight. What? If you're a family member and you have a widow in your family, take care of her. That's what it says. That's what's acceptable in the sight of God. Not left to anybody else. And the first place with a family member with a widow is not the church. It's the family. What did God establish first in Scripture? The family, then the church. Genesis 1, 2, and 3 is the family of God. I'll take a man and a woman, and I will make one out of them, and they will be married, and they will operate in matrimony that is holy unto me. Yeah, and then it was several thousand years later, we have the birth of the church. You say, well, really, Rob? Oh, I just want you to remember one little pretty major story in Scripture. Her name is Ruth. She has a book. She got a husband late in life. His name is Boaz. Levirate tradition. She was left in bereavement without, in a land that was not her land. And at the foot of the one who would provide, God gave her her peace in Boaz. Ruth, I've marked you out. And I've got to go to the next of kin. And if he will let you be my wife, I'll have you even this day. But if not, that's God's provision. Because what did God establish in the Old Testament? Family member a brother would take that widow and make her his wife and take care of her for two reasons. She carried on the name, and secondly, she had land and property. She had a means to make a living. And all of a sudden, Christ shows up. Yeah. And at the age of 33 years old, he becomes my lever at tradition. I was lonely. I was without. I was dead in my trespasses and sin. And he died for me, and he adopted me. And when he was resurrected, he gave me a name that's above every name, and it's in the person of Jesus Christ. And now I have hope. I have a name, and I have resources, and it's all because he is my king. You think it matters? This is what the gospel looks like. We take care of our own. Verse 4 leads us into, really, verse 8. But, in contrast, if, see that if? That's a first-class conditional if. That means since. I told you that this is corrective. This is where I got it. Don't for 1 minute not be a good Berean. You say, Rob, I want to see where you got it. I got it right here. If, since. But since some are not providing for their own. That's how it's read in the original text. And especially of their own household. What happens? Here's the warning. He's denied the faith and is worse than an unbeliever, an infidel. You say, well, Rob, is that grounds for losing your salvation? Absolutely not. But here's the weightiness of this reality. When we don't take care of our widows as family members or as the church who has a widow indeed in your congregation, when we don't, we have denied the faith. We've denied the purpose and work of Jesus Christ in the body through our ignorance, disobedience, unwillingness. And it is likened unto the fact that we have no excuse, because even the lost world gets this. Guys, I've watched this, and so have you. I have watched pagan families watch their mother or grandmother lose their mate, and they take care of them. They even get this. There's no excuse for the body of Christ. It's like we walked away from the faith that we were called in, the compassion that Christ delivered salvation to us, and we've taken that compassion, we've kicked it to the side, and we're no better than the world. In fact, we're worse than the world because we know better. It's not all right to walk away from our own. Guys, even the animal kingdom gets this. I watched this Friday on the Nature Channel. Of all places. Yeah, that's really theological, and it's deep in doctrine. Little does the people know they put this together. This is godly. And they just did it because it's in nature what they saw in storks. There's storks all over this cliff, and there's a vast measure, expanse of water. And all of these storks are nested on this cliff next to the shore and the banks of the water. And it's just lapping against the rocks. And it's hundreds of feet down. And in one nest, there's a mama feeding her babies. She has fish. She chews on them. And in turn, regurgitates that into those little babies' beaks, and it fills up their little water, their little waddle, and they're sitting there eating, and the mom's just going away at it, feeding these babies. Interesting thing. In the nest right next to it are the babies feeding an elderly stork. Mama was giving the babies food. They would ingest some and then turn to this feeble, elderly stork and feed that stork who is in need. They didn't go to school to learn that. They didn't get a stork manual and say to that little baby stork, okay, now when grandma comes to the nest, you take half and give half to her. That is the nature and rhythm of God's creation. That's what it looks like. You said, Rob, where do you get it? Because that's what the text says. If you have a widow in your family, and that widow has parents or grandparents that are alive, would you just treat them like they treated you when you could not do for yourself? You parent them with the goodness of resources that God has given you in hope. Give it back. Give it back. Guys, we're living testimony of this. You're telling me that it was the natural rhythm of my mom to want to and to watch my wife mirror this, to get up with a sick child at 2 a.m. after having spent all day long caring for a small child in desperate need, and they come to their feet like a warrior when they hear the chirp from the room. Mama, I'm sick. My kids wouldn't even hardly get that sentence out, and their feet are on the floor, and they're into that room, and they're taking care of that, and they're cleaning up after them. They're feeding them. They're taking care of them. I've watched even my own wife suckle our children, and it wasn't always convenient. But if they were in need, Mama worked. And to this day, we'll all be seated. And I watch Mama's working. I've oftentimes even told my wife, honey, do you ever go to bed? Well, I started a load of laundry. Yeah, you started at 9:45. And I need to get it in the dryer before I go to bed. Who does that? But a mama. A grandma. Guys, in the society in which we live today, I thank God for grandmas. I watch more grandmothers raising kids than I do moms in this day in which we live. And I watch this elderly little lady walking this little bitty kid. No way that's her kid. That's her grandchild. Taking them up to the steps of the school. And in great prayer and supplication, sending them in to be educated as a learner of academia. What if we did the same with the body of Christ? Because that's with promise. That investment has a return, and it is good. You rear a child in the admonition of the Lord, they will not forsake the father. And as a family goes, so goes our society. Guys, birds get it. I think the church needs to get it. And please don't look at me and say, well, Robert, don't we? I pray to God we do. I pray that if there's a single person that is lonely and is without in our church, then with all the courage that it takes to ask for help, that when they do, we meet their need with royalty. Not just to get them by, but to get them by with much. Widows indeed. Widows that have families. Would we take the challenge today? Well, I want to leave you with this. Say, Robbie, is there an example in Scripture that is weighty? I mean, you know, I see this and I want to see an exemplar. All right. Glad you ask. John chapter 19. The place is Calvary. I want to begin reading in verse 26, and only because of time. And I want to read down really through verse 30, because it leads us into the communion at the Lord's table. What do we remember on a day like this? I want to tell you just in recap what's happened in the last 24 hours. Jesus has eaten his last supper with his disciples. He's washed their feet, and he has a traitor in the group. Oh, by the way, he washed his feet too. He goes to a place that he occupied and was really his habit when he was in the area of Jerusalem, to the Garden of Gethsemane. And one exits the group, and so we have 11. 8 of them stay at kind of the outer wall, and their petition was to pray. He takes 3 of them to the inner sanctum of that prayer meeting: Peter, James, and John. And he begins to pray. And he prays something like this: Father, if there's any way this cup could be removed from me, would you remove it? But if not, thy will be done. A few hours pass, and 3 on the inner group, they fall asleep, and he has to wake them up. Scripture, we believe, 3 times. All of a sudden, a caravan of mobs with evil intent and maliciousness in their heart appear on the horizon and walk to the garden, and they arrest our Lord Jesus Christ as the 12th, kiss him on the cheek to identify, this is the one whom calls himself Jesus. He goes through 6 trials in the next few hours, 3 by the Jews and 3 by the Romans. And in every one of those, it's trumped up, every bit of it. He is flogged to the place of 1 death stroke away from dying on the table of wrath. Woven on his head, crammed onto his brow, is a mesquite branch full of thorns and thistles, crammed down on his head with the reluctancy of statement, this is the King of the Jews. A robe wrapped around his shoulders and taken out to the praetorium, and he is identified by the Roman government, this is your king. Battered and beat. Taken to a place outside the city, on his way to Golgotha, the place of the skull of crucifixion, he's laid on a piece of wood that just a few hundreds of years before he created by his mouth. He's laid on that piece of wood, outstretched between heaven and earth, naked in humility. To his wrist and the top of both of his feet were driven an awl, a nail, and raised up for all men to see the Son of God. Pain in his humanity like you can't believe. Humiliation like none of us will ever go through. Spat upon. Slandered verbally. Even his clothes are being gambled away at the foot of the cross just to have the tunic. I want the seamless tunic of the priest in my possession. And all of this is going on. And on one side, he's rebuking sin. And on the other side, he's inviting one to come to be with him in paradise. Now look at the text. Verse 26. All this is going on. When Jesus, therefore, saw his mother. Whew. And the disciple whom he loved standing nearby, that's John, he said to his mother, woman, mom, reverence, mom, behold your son. Then he said to the disciple, behold your mother. And from that hour, the disciple took her into his household. Why? Because God takes care of widows and orphans. Of all the things that Jesus could have done at Calvary, He looked into the dear face of his mother and said, "You will be without. I will make a way for you, not only in salvation and eternity in future, but I will, before I speak the words, it is finished. The work has been done. The sacrifice has been made. The goal of my life has been taken, and the Father has been found in well-pleasing. I am the Savior." He looked at his mom and he said, "Mom, don't you worry. I got this. John, don't you dare let my mom do without. You take care of her like it's your own mother. Mom, behold your son." And she looks at John thinking, "Man, you're my son." No, he's your son of provision on this earth. Mom, look at John. He's your hope. John, you treat her like mom. Big deal or little deal. Take care of our own. And the correction has been made. The provision of his goodness has been stated. And from that day on, and you say, "Well, Rob, how do you know he took care of her?" Look at the text. From that moment on, where did she live? In John's household. Folks, let me just tell you something. John didn't go without. He took care of himself and his family. He took care of his mother too, Mary, the mother of Jesus Christ. That's what the text says. How weighty is this passage? God took care of his mother on the cross of sacrifice for the sins of men. How much greater is it for us, having been given the example? We don't deny our faith, and we are not treated as infidels on believers. We take care of our own. Father, thank you for this day. What a great grace that you have provided for us in salvation. I pray now that as we enter into this time that is most holy in Scripture, the meal of remembrance, a communion around those things of great promise, that we would with one accord say the great promise for us is we have been provided with a rescuer, Jesus Christ our Savior, our Lord. As we look at this passage, let us be reminded of the great sacrifice of Calvary and the multitudes that would witness on that day and the multitudes that have followed that have trusted by faith in the person and finished work of Jesus Christ and repented and turned of their sin to find hope in the one who saved us and gave himself in our place. Father, we thank you. We love you. In Jesus' precious name, we offer this prayer. Amen. Deacons, if I could have you come, looks like we got a couple and 10 to the table. I'm going to take the text this morning out of the gospel message of Luke. Dr. Luke records not only the preparing of the Passover, but he does a tremendous job in chapter 22 of Luke to really accent that moment in the Last Supper, the Lord's Supper. I want you to then make your direction, if you will, to Luke 22, beginning in verse 14. And I want to pick up this, really, this setting. And I want to read it just like it is in Scripture, down through verse 23. "And when the hour had come, he reclined at the table," that being Christ, "and the apostles with him. And he said to them, 'I have earnestly desired to eat this Passover with you before I suffer,'" that is his death. "For I say to you, I shall never again eat it until it is fulfilled in the kingdom of God." This is the last time until the next time when we're all there in the kingdom. "And he had taken the cup. When he had taken the cup and given thanks, he said, 'Take this and share this among yourselves. For I say to you, I will not drink of the fruit of the vine from now on until the kingdom of God comes.' And when he had taken some bread and given thanks, he broke it and he gave it to them, saying, 'This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me.' And in the same way, he took the cup after that they had eaten, and he said this cup is to be poured out for you, is the new covenant in my blood. But behold, the hand of the one betraying me is with me on the table. For indeed the Son of Man is going as it has been determined, but woe to that man by whom he is betrayed. And they began to discuss among themselves which one of them it might be who was going to do this thing. Father, as we enter into this time of communion, cleanse our hearts that we might receive this in purity, undefiled religion. Father, we would see the sacrifice at Calvary made known to us in this preempt to the things that are going to follow in our past having been done. As the hearts of the disciples are being prepared in this passage, Father, we are being prepared a meal of remembrance of what has happened. Find us faithful, living out what we are in Christ Jesus, our Lord. Father, thank you for taking upon yourself what we owed in full. We love you and thank you. In Jesus' precious name we pray. Amen. This morning we're going to do it just a little bit different if we could. The men are going to pass out the bread and the fruit of the cup all in one time. So they're hand the bread out first and then come back and we'll take the cup. And then we're going to talk through and do it in the order in which it was done in Scripture. And on that night, the eve of his death at Calvary, Scripture says in verse 19, and when he had taken some bread and given thanks. Ken, would you please, for the body of Jesus Christ.
Thank you so much for this bread. Representing your broken body, pierced for us.
Scripture says, having broken the bread, he said this to his disciples, "This is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Scripture says in verse 20, in the same way, he took the cup. John, would you please? For the blood of Jesus Christ. He said this, "This cup which is poured out for you is the new covenant in my blood. Do this in remembrance of me." And we know that in 1 Corinthians in chapter 11, in verse 26, there's a tremendous promise. Well, how often and what do we do? Well, as often as you do this, you do it this way. In remembrance of me, that's the proclamation of the gospel of Jesus Christ to all people. And remember this, until I come again. That's a promise of return. How often? As often as you do it. How? In declaration of the gospel, the good news. Why? He's coming back. Are we ready? Father, we thank you for the day in which you have provided for us the provision of your grace in salvation, in practical living. Father, it is the demand of the word that we find the expression of the word most practiced in our habits. It's not enough to say, as Titus would bring the churches of Crete to this understanding, they profess with their mouth, but their hearts are far from me. Their deeds are evil in the sight of God. They say they're believers, but they're not. Why? Because they don't do the deeds of the Father. Father, I don't know how much clearer it can be when questioned over and over and over. Your son, oftentimes in sharp rebuke, "I'm about my Father's business. Whatever my Father has sent me to do, I want to faithfully do." Father, praise be your name. He did in full. Teach us your ways that we might walk upright in the righteousness of faith for your glory ultimately and for our benefit in life. Father, we want to be the church. It's acceptable in your sight that as you took care of us, we take care of others. In Jesus' precious name, we offer this prayer. Amen.
Thank you, Rob. Yeah. We'll just kind of hold on to your cups. At the end of it, we'll pick them up right after our closing songs. If you'll stand and sing with us, we're going to end with "Light the Fire."
Stand to praise you, but I fall on my knees. My spirit is willing, but my flesh is so weak.
Light the
fire. Light the
fire in my soul.
The power of your healing. the fire in my heart again.